I was a kid, my dad would fix cars in his free time. He would get that car up on ramps, bust out that giant red toolbox, and tinker away for who knows how long. He would joke that he could probably build a whole new car for the amount of time that he worked on that 55 Chevy of his. I thought that might have been true then, waiting for him again while he finished up that one last lug nut. But now I know that isn't true, because since then it seems like it takes an exponentially longer amount of time to get any kind of automotive design finished. But then again, I'm not sure if that 55 Chevy of his was ever finished either. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. Automotive designs of any sort can be a long and tedious challenge, filled with a wide range of safety requirements, internal memory considerations, and persnickety power problems. In today's Chalk Talk, Marcelo Williams Silva from Infineon joins me to chat about the Traveo II microcontrollers that are dealing with all of these automotive-related challenges with ease. Marcelo and I take a closer look at the power efficiency, smart I/O signal paths, and the over-the-air firmware updates included in this new MCU family that will make all the time-saving difference in your next automotive design. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about this topic from Infineon. Hi, Marcelo. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you.
Okay, so today we're talking about microcontrollers for automotive designs. But Marcelo, before we get started, can you give me a brief introduction about Infineon?
Infineon is a lead microcontroller supplier for a while since it was a Siemens semiconductor back in the 90s. And we are able to supply on automotive applications, not just the microcontroller part, but the power and the sensors as well. And with the former Cypress company joining us, we have also a portfolio that can supply connectivity and trust platform, HMI, human interface parts. So we have a very big portfolio to support automotive applications.
Okay, so Marcelo, in terms of automotive design, what kinds of trends are you seeing in this space?
Today, we have three mega trends, that is electrification, connectivity, and the autonomy. So the autonomous cars, okay? So Infineon is focusing their products on these three big buckets. So on the electrification part, we have the part of the charger, the car itself, the inverter, so everything that requires motion, okay? And then we have the connectivity part, that these cars are connected to some network and to the user itself. So we have products for these applications as well. And on the autonomy part, we have all the radars, lidars, everything that requires that the human is not in control of the vehicle anymore. And this increases safety and reliability of the transportation.
Okay, so what kind of components are we looking at in an automotive design?
In automotive design today, we have the power parts, which requires the inverter, the onboard and offboard charging, okay, that requires power as well. We have all the sensing part, which means like magnetic sensors, radar sensors, lighting sensors, movement sensor in cabin, which is very nice. So we can recognize how many occupants you have. So it's something that is popping up now on the automotive applications. And then we have the microcontroller and microprocessing parts that is able to gathering the sensor parts. So an act, processing the data, an act either in a braking system or LED headlights or a heads-up display. And it's where the Traveo and Infineon microcontrollers coming up to the scene. Talking about our portfolio, by the way, we are completing 1 year of a Cypress merger and acquisition this week. And in the past, Infineon has just proprietary microcontrollers, which includes our RX portfolio, that is a tri-core one. And they are high-end microcontrollers. So our customers approach us in the past and say, oh, Infineon, why you don't have a low-end microcontroller or a medium-end, just the high-end ones? We trust on the high-end ones, but sometimes they are too much for our application. That comes up our Traveo portfolio and PSoC Automotive as well. So these two devices, they have ARM-based cores. They fit the low-end applications and mid-end applications very well because of the ARM-based devices, and they are capable up to ASIL-B.
Okay, so can we dive into the details of the Traveo and RX?
Yeah, sure. If you compare the Traveo and RX devices that are mid to high-end ones, it's very easy to differentiate and to find the right spot for each one. So on the RX one, you have the grade zero. You have the ASIL-D capability for safety applications. You have a bigger microcontroller with up to 6 CPUs, up to 16 megabytes of flash, 24 lane, 20 can. So it's a big device for a higher safety capability. And if you say, oh, Marcelo, I don't need a lot of safety and I don't need this complexity. I need a microcontroller to achieve the mid-end application. So then it comes Traveo, that is a very good fit because you still have ASIL-K 100 grade and you have up to ASIL-B capability. You have the single core and dual core up to M7, up to 8 megabytes of flash. And you have as well the low power consumption feature on those devices. So there is the sweet spot between RX and Traveo.
Okay, so Marcelo, once I have my specific design in mind, what steps do I need to clarify what solution I will need?
Yeah, that's a very good point because people get very confused when they are selecting the right microcontroller. Even myself, after 20 years working with microcontrollers, I get very confused with multiple offers. So we have a decision flow matrix where you are able to select which devices in the automotive application you can go and you can work with. So the first question you should do is ASIL-D required? If you say yes, RX, no doubt about it. If you say no, I can work with up to ASIL-B. So then you have to check your internal memory requirements. Then you're still between RX, PSoC, and Traveo. And after you check the internal memory requirements, you can check about the scalability. If you need a smaller microcontroller, you can work with Auto PSoC because they are ARM-based as well. If you need a more powerful device inside our ARM portfolio, you have two options. We have one family device that we call it Traveo Body, and we have the Traveo cluster that is able to drive displays and clusters.
Okay, so Marcelo, can we take a closer look at the Traveo? What does this buy me as an engineer?
Yeah, the Traveo, they have a lot of nice features for the automotive application with the flexibility of an ARM device. So first thing that we should highlight on the Traveo is the low power efficiency. So these devices are capable to retain RAM operations and memory and some peripherals at a low power consumption. We'll talk about this later onwards. The performance that you have up to two dual core M7 devices, that is a very capable device to process a real-time operation. You have scalability, so pin-to-pin compatibility and the memory scalability inside the portfolio. The safety that we already mentioned up to ASIL-B. We have the graphics and audio performance on the Traveo cluster devices. That we have devices available in the market today, but we are releasing along 2021 multiple devices addressing the cluster applications and display applications. We have the security part, that is the HSM, the hardware security model, plus the firmware over the air updatability. We have multiple things related to security and connectivity, including KNFD and gigabit Ethernet.
Okay, so Marcelo, do you have options in terms of the amount of flash memory each of these MCUs can have?
On the Traveo portfolio, we separate them on the high-end ones and the entry level. So the entry level are the ones between 520 kilobytes of flash up to 4 megabytes, and the high-end ones is 4 megabytes to 8 megabytes, okay? So below 512K, if you say, Marcelo, 512 is still too much. You have the PSoC automotive version that is up to 512. And then on this range, you have all the Traveo parts that comes from 16-pin TQFP option to 220-pin BGA option. And you see between the 100-pin family and the 176-pin family, we have pin-to-pin compatibility between the entry level and the high-end level. So it means that you have scalability on your applications as well.
Okay, so Marcelo, if I'm working on a body control module, what would be the best solution for my design?
As you can see here, I'm showing a diagram block of an entry-level superset device, which you have on the TV2BE. You have -1 megabyte and you have up to 4 megabytes availability on the entry level. And as you can see on the diagram block, you have an ARM Cortex M4 single CPU on the entry level. And you say, oh, Marcelo, but there is another CPU. There is a Cortex M0 there. This CPU is working with the HSM part, but you are able to use this CPU. If you're not using the HSM, you're able to use part of the CPU instructions for your application as well. And you see multiple peripherals and connections here, including KNFD, 12-bit ADC connectivity, and power module management, PPUs. So everything that is already well known on the ARM architecture, but now being used for automotive-specific applications. And if you don't need an entry level, and if you need a high-end one, 1M4 is not enough for my application. I need more performance, but I'm not on a NARIX level yet. ACLB is enough. I just need more performance. You are capable to use the superset high-end of the body applications. And then on these ones, you have a dual CPU Cortex M7 up to dual CPU. You still have your Cortex M0 for the HSM. You have your MPU, MCU, eFuse, the 10-channel KNFD, and you have the ADC, FlexRay, Ethernet. What is nice to highlight on both families is on the left side, you see the voltage supplies can go from 2.7 volts up to 5.5 volts, which is nice for automotive application that you don't need anymore this LDO that keeps your voltage in 3.3 volts or less. So these devices are capable and they have I/O capabilities as well to operate on 5 volts, which turns this device very flexible for many automotive usage, even though you have to retrofit with old applications. So to replace old microcontrollers that you have working on 5 volts as well.
So Marcelo, can we also talk about the Traveo 2? What are we looking at in terms of performance with this one?
As I mentioned on the diagram block, you have two options. On the low-end one, you have the single Cortex M4 CPU, and the high-end, you have up to dual M7. Those ones, they increase, comparing to the previous Traveo family, up to almost 4 times the processing capability of those devices. And then, because if you have an M0 plus CPU dedicated for security, that if you are not using the security, you are capable to use the CPU for other applications or peripheral as well. This increases a lot the processing capability. And on top of that, we added the most common automotive interfaces that are KNFD and gigabit Ethernet. So you are capable with those CPUs plus the DMA, the peripherals setup, and the KNFD and gigabit Ethernet, you are capable to support most of the automotive requirements nowadays.
Okay, so Marcelo, I know that power efficiency is super important in these kinds of designs. What's the power story here?
That's a very nice thing, Amelia, here on the automotive trends, okay? Power efficiency in the past used to be nice, but not mandatory. Why nice? Oh, I have a car that's parked on the parking spot and I should be on low power or no power just to save the battery because I don't want to have my car out of battery if it's a summer or winter vehicle. Nowadays, power efficiency becomes a sales argument as part of the go-to-market strategy for many suppliers, which means if I have a low power consumption, I can have more car autonomy if I'm a supplier of an XEV car, which means I can sell more cars because I'm doing more mileage per watt. Taking this into consideration, power efficiency became a very nice, good player in the automotive market. That's why Traveo has a sweet spot on these applications. Traveo has a 35% improvement in power efficiency compared to the previous one. And what a nice thing from Traveo is the deep sleep mode. The deep sleep mode, as you can check here on the mid column, You can have retention of a system run and peripheral on deep sleep mode, consuming up to 35 microamps. Oh, Marcelo, but why this retention is so important? In the past, our competitors or other automotive applications, you put the device on hibernate mode, which means the device is falling asleep. And when I have any event coming, I have to power up the device. The device will be up. It takes some precious seconds to be up. And then I make the instruction or the function. Nowadays, you have some things like a Bluetooth door activation or NFC contactless keys. And the user wants to have this in real time. So I come closer to my car and I want my car turns on right away or opens right away. Then the retention of RAM and peripherals became very important. Because if you have this RAM retention and the peripheral retention, when you have an outside event, you can turn the microcontroller super fast. And for the user, it's transparent. It's a real-time operation. So that's why Traveo, a deep sleep RAM and peripheral rotation, becomes a key player on those automotive markets as well.
Okay, so Marcelo, signal path is also a very important aspect in automotive designs. So what can this MCU do in terms of I/O signal paths?
This is something that is very nice on the Traveo part. So the former Cypress, they have a patent called Smart I/O. What it means on Smart I/O? Most of the PCB designers, they will stick with the idea that this device, they have the IOs on the left side and I have to reroute to the right side. Oh, it's very complicated. Or some of the software designers will say, oh, this pin is straight connected to this one. I need a jumper or an internal jumper. So I have to keep in mind that I have to do it in my code. It was the old-fashioned way to do it. So with the Smart I/O, you are able to interconnect internal pins on the device, either with bypass, either with some events that are hardware monitored. So you are not taking an event as a software interruption. You can connect points that can trigger some devices or some peripherals directly by hardware. This makes your design much easier. And it makes more scalable if you are using a smaller microcontroller that you're not using all the pins, or using a bigger microcontroller that you not just need to jumper some of the pins. So you can do it inside the microcontroller and you don't need any line of code for that.
So Marcelo, what about firmware over air updates? You mentioned that earlier. Can we take a closer look at that part of the system?
Sure. Firmware over the air updates, it became mandatory on the past year. Why? You're seeing a lot of cluster applications and interactions between the user and the vehicle. And since the peripherals and the software and all the ecosystem are becoming bigger and bigger and more interoperable and they need more connectivity, for that, you need the software updates almost in a weekly basis, and during the develop, sometimes in a daily basis. So instead of you wait for the user to go to a dealership every 1 year or every 10,000 miles or any time that they have to do any maintenance, you can make software over the air updates available. But software over the air, they can be true software over the air, or they can be they call it fake software over the air. Why? Because first you download the file, you wait until the car is down, and then you start reprogramming the model. So they call it not true software over the air update. And that's why Traveo, it's nice. It's because we support the true software over the air update. So true FOTA, which means that you don't have to interrupt the service. You don't have to make sure that the car is down. You have a dual bank of flash inside the Traveo 2. So you can download the software until the user can drive the car, can use the car, can do anything with the car. So you download in the second bank. And when you have the consolidated software and you have the validation, then you make the swap of these banks in real time. And then the software is updated. So you don't have to stop the user to use the vehicle or using the car to make the software over the air. So that means the true FOTA. And we support this on the Traveo family as well.
Okay, so Marcelo, no chalk talk about automotive design would be complete without looking at functional safety. So what are we really looking at in terms of functional safety with the Traveo 2?
Infineon is well known about the functional safe capability, not just on the microcontroller, but in our power parts and sensors parts as well. So that's why we have this ProCell quality level. What means ProCell? It means that Infineon is capable to provide you all the documents and the tests and all the features that enables you to have a functional safety, holistic system approach on your application. And it's not different with Traveo. So we have all the safety manuals available, all the safety grades and critical application validations as well. So everything is available as for all the other part numbers from Infineon since analog, sensor, and power. So you are capable to go to a specific page or talk with our team about it, and you are capable to download all the manuals and everything that you need to turn your application on a safety high level grade one.
Okay, so Marcelo, can we dig into some of the other aspects of the Traveo 2? What about the software side of things?
That's a very nice point, Amelia. So the software part of the Traveo, it's the same of any ARM application. So we support multiple IDEs from the ARM ecosystem, and we have our own boards development as well. We have low-cost kits, and we have high-end kits, and you're capable to debug the Traveo applications by the very common and well-known JTAG plug. So you're capable to use debugging tools from ARM ecosystem as well. So talking about the programmers and debuggers, we support IAR, Greenhouse, and multiple IDEs from the ARM ecosystem. We have the debuggers and the tracers available for ARM as well, and they are all plug and play for Traveo ecosystem. And last but not least, one thing that I want to highlight here that is key for our Traveo ecosystem are the low-cost kits. So we know if you are a startup or if you're starting engaging with a microcontroller, how important it is to have a low-end kit. I remember when I started working with microcontroller more than a decade ago, it kits cost more than $20,000. So you have to try to take it from a friend or someone in your company. And sometimes you have queues to use this kit. So it was very complicated times. And nowadays we have these low-end kits that they are plug and play. We have most of the basic software and ecosystem available to download on the internet for free. And with Traveo is not different. So we have our Traveo evaluation hardware, the basic kit, which comes with Arduino pin compatibility. And you have the debugger as well. So you can take this kit, plug in an Arduino shield if you need some connectivity or some hardware extension, and you're ready to go.
So Marcelo, if I need a little more help, where should I go?
That's a nice thing in a transition from Infineon compared to 5 years ago to now. We have a new digital platform and digital web page platform and support. And with Traveo is not different. So we have our collaboration platform in our Infineon web page. So if you go to Infineon, a web page, and on the top you see My Infineon, you're able to log in. You enter in a, we call it My ICP, which means Infineon Collaboration Platform. And inside your MyACP, you have all documentation, software, guidance, everything related to Traveo and other Infineon products. And you have access to our forum and support teams as well.
Excellent. So, Marcelo, if my audience wants even more information, where would you suggest going?
Sure. You can go to our Infineon website. You go to infineon.com and look for microcontrollers. And inside microcontrollers, you have RX, Traveo, PSOC, our embedded power SoC devices as well. If it's not enough, we have a very nice page inside Infineon called infineon.com/makers that you have all the devices that the key makers can start working right away. And all those devices are supported by Mouser. So you can go on Mouser website as well and figure out more kits and more devices available from Infineon side. And if that's not enough, you have my email contact. Please reach me out and I will be able to support you as well.
Excellent. Well, Marcelo, I think that's all I have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity again. And looking forward for the next one, Amelia.
And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about this topic from Infineon. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, head on over to the Chalk Talk section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or head on over to YouTube, youtube.com/EEJournal.